Thank you, Finn, and thank you to everyone for joining today's webinar. As Inorganic Ventures is a certified reference material manufacturer, the primary goal today is to provide information regarding new product offerings that have been designed to meet the USP and Q3D specifications. We'll also touch briefly upon the criteria that have been used to design these products. And the presentation is relatively short, perhaps 10 to 15 minutes, and there will be time at the end for questions and answers. Additionally, the material will be posted on our website shortly after we conclude the presentation for future reference. It's appropriate to spend a little bit of time discussing the background of USP 232 and the ICH Q3D specifications. The initial specifications from 2012 to 2013 have changed significantly, and this has impacted how Inorganic Ventures has designed appropriate reference materials. The good news is that from 2015 onward, the USP specifications have not changed, and as of 2016, USP has additionally included the 9 additional Q3D elements. And as of 2017, both USP and the ICH specifications are fully aligned. With regard to the stock product offerings that Inorganic Ventures has produced, when USP was originally proposed several years ago, we introduced new stock products to meet customer requests. And over the next few years, the USP limits changed, and we responded with new stock products accordingly. It was at this time that we began to develop an appreciation for the significant variability in what reference material users were looking for with respect to compliance with 232. The agreement between the USP and ICH specifications in the past 2 years has brought much needed clarity to the issue, and as a result, we have created 6 new stock products for 2018 that are consistent with the 232 and Q3D specifications. And what we want to do is to look at these products in more detail in the next couple of slides. So one simple way to describe our new product offerings is to use the tables provided by USP and ICH as part of their documentation. Hopefully many of you are familiar with the tables describing the concentration limits or permitted daily exposures for the 24 elements covered by these methods. The data table on the right of the slide corresponds to Table 1 of the latest USP 232 publication and Table A21 in the appendix of Q3D. We've based our product offerings upon the element classes described in the methods. One product worth noting is IV Stock 68, where silver was separated from the other Class 2B elements for compatibility reasons, and we'll discuss these reasons in more detail shortly. 5 of our newest product offerings are outlined in the table, with the acid matrix for each product listed as well. And I want you to note that the Class 3 elements are Stock 69 product represents element concentrations that are 10 times lower than specified in the table. And the primary reason for this is that there are long-term stability concerns when considering concentrations that are well above 1,000 parts per million for this particular mixture of elements. And we'll discuss our design criteria in just a moment. The 6th product that we are offering for 2018 is based upon the limits described in Table 3 of USP 232, which corresponds to Table A22 in Q3D. This data table represents the individual component approach described in 232, and it's also known as Option 1 in the Q3D method. This particular product, IV Stock 70, represents a combination of all 24 of the elements specified in the methods. And this is possible due to the lower concentrations that are detailed for the Class 3 elements. This is the only product that we're currently offering as a stock that's not directly based upon the permissible daily exposure table. And it primarily reflects the number of unique requests that we've observed for these element concentrations. And this provides a nice transition for a brief discussion of the design criteria we followed when formulating these new products. So as for the design of our stock IV products, over the past 4 to 5 years, we've received many requests for standards related to 232 and Q3D. The information presented on this slide is just a summary of the variability that we have observed. We have approximately 45,000 unique custom standard requests in our database, and if you screen these requests for elements and concentrations related to 232 and Q3D, there are well over 100 unique formulations that people have asked for over the past several years. The variability is frequently resulting from the omission of certain elements, or people are asking for multiples of the specified concentrations. And what we've observed is that most end users are focused on the oral permissible daily exposure limits, with fewer requests for the parenteral specifications. However, many of the combinations of parenteral limits are already captured and approved for manufacture in our database. So if you have specific requests regarding the parenteral limits, please let us know. So a little bit of information about the criteria that we've used for designing these products. These slides are going to focus on chemistry, and the two things that we're primarily looking for with product design, which are going to be stability and compatibility. Of these two considerations, safety is going to be of primary concern, and you'll note that I've highlighted osmium in the slide. It's also important to note that our goal is a minimum shelf life of 3 years for any product and at least 4 years for stock products. And for the 6 new products that we are offering in 2018, all of them will have a 4-year shelf life. The periodic table diagram lists all 24 elements that are part of the methods and the stability compatibility concerns that are worth noting. For this particular slide, what we're focusing on are nitric acid matrices. And while all of these elements can be prepared in a nitric acid matrix, safety concerns regarding the volatility of osmium as a tetroxide argue against this approach. And for some precious metals, it's simply not possible to avoid including chloride for stability. And this can create real problems if silver is one of your elements of interest. Another popular matrix that people frequently use is hydrochloric acid, and if we consider the stability and compatibility of these 24 elements in an HCl matrix, overall HCl is a better choice, particularly if you are required to test for all the class 2B elements. The concerns about silver stability and hydrochloric acid can be avoided if the acid to silver ratio is high enough, though it is important to note that photosensitivity of the silver in an HCl matrix must be accounted for. And just as a reference, if you take all 24 elements that are specified in the two methods and they are present at concentrations of 100 parts per million, we have a mixture that has a demonstrated stability that exceeds 2 years in an HCl trace HF matrix. So you can use that as a point of reference moving forward if you, in your own lab, are preparing your standards yourself. The information on this slide and the preceding slide are captured in a white paper that's located in the tech center of our website, and you can use that for reference as well. Finally, what we want to do is start to talk a little bit about preparation tips for the 232 and Q3D elements. This slide is brief because the purpose of this presentation was primarily just to focus on the product offerings and not delve too much into the details of how you would actually use these standards. But we do have a couple of suggestions for stability and compatibility of these products. One thing that's important to note is that our criteria is for at least a 3-year shelf life, and this does not apply to diluted working standards. Many of the restrictions imposed by a long shelf life may be disregarded for the preparation of diluted standards that you're going to use relatively quickly. Another suggestion is that if you can avoid testing for osmium, please do so. It will simplify many of the aspects of the analytical process from sample preparation to measurement. And many of the technical questions that we receive are related to the measurement of osmium. Other than osmium, the two elements of these 24 elements that are most likely to present challenges are mercury and gold. And this is going to be particularly so or true if your process requires the use of a nitric acid matrix. We have a great deal of information on our website regarding the stability of these two elements in nitric acid. And if you have any other questions, please don't hesitate to contact us. Lastly, we just want to point out that if you're preparing your own mixtures and you need to analyze thallium as part of the 2B element group, please just make sure that your starting material ensures that thallium is in the +3 oxidation state, or else it can precipitate as a chloride salt in the presence of precious metals. Simply put, thallium will behave just like silver if it's in the +1 oxidation state, and you can run into problems if you're measuring the 2B elements, such as osmium, the precious metals, and you want to include thallium as part of that measurement. So this was just a quick overview of the new products that we're offering for the USP232 and ICH-Q3D specifications. There's a lot of detail regarding the analysis and sample preparation that would be part of a separate conversation, but hopefully the information provided here today will be useful. And as always, free technical support is available to everyone. We ask you to contact us by email, phone, whatever method works best for you, and we'd be happy to help you out as best we can. Thank you for your time.
If you'd like to submit...
Oh, go ahead, Tim. And it's time for questions if anybody has any.
If you'd like to submit a question, you can submit it by going to the Q&A box on the right-hand side. Just type your question, make sure it's set to all panelists, and click send.
Okay, so for those who are still in attendance, I have started to figure out the Q&A part. I'm going to ask or address some of these questions. One question, is it over already? Will you be answering questions out loud? Yes. It's a short presentation, and we simply wanted to offer some details regarding the stock products that will be available in 2018, and I'd be happy to answer any technical questions, though. As for when the website will be updated with the new standards, the expectation is this would happen at the beginning of January, and they should be fully available for perusal on the website no later than the first or second week of January 2018. There's another question regarding, can the slides be downloaded? I do know that the presentation will be available on our website, and my expectation is that slides will be available for download, probably as a PDF. We will certainly make sure that if you wish to have these slides for your own personal reference, that they will be available to you. I have another question. Do we have an emailer going out that we could adapt for the United Kingdom? I would have to consult the marketing folks on that one, but I fully expect that this is just the beginning of a kind of targeted marketing approach to the USP-232-Q3D specifications. We understand that there's a great deal of questions in the industry regarding the application of these specifications and standards, so we will do everything we possibly can to help end users navigate their way through compliance with 232 and Q3D. I have a question. Have you had any requests for internal standards that support the Q3D assays? The answer is we've had many requests for internal standards that support the Q3D assays. The primary difficulty that we've had in generating specific recommendations has been the variability in the elements that people are required to test for. It's not such a problem for the low mass elements such as arsenic and selenium, but if you have to analyze for the full suite of precious metals, when you get to the high mass range above about mass 175, and you have to analyze for osmium, et cetera, mercury, then your options for precious metal or for internal standardization become somewhat limited. And the brief answer to the question is that we've had many requests for internal standards, and if people would contact us with their specific element list that they need to have tested, we'd be happy to make specific recommendations for what we feel would be the most appropriate internal standardization program. Another question, will weight weight be included in the certificate of analyses? That's a fantastic question. Weight weight for the certified concentrations can be provided on the certificate of analyses upon request. By default, the concentrations are going to be in weight volume, but if you already have an existing product and would like the information provided in weight weight, we can certainly do that. A simpler approach is that if you're requesting a new product, or if you need an alteration for a stock product or more information for a stock product, what we can do is include that as well. We understand that for those people who are analyzing solid materials and are doing all their sample preparations by weight, which is an approach that we highly recommend, then that weight-weight data on the certificate analyses is critical, and we can certainly help with that. Okay, I have a question. We're using standards for the big four heavy metal testing. The concentration for them are parts per billion levels. Do we have to use the density of the standard solution if we do a dilution by weight? This is, again, a great question. Anytime you do a sample preparation or a dilution of anything, if you are diluting a weight into a weight, then the concentration units are not going to change. An example would be that if you have a standard that is certified in micrograms per mil or weight volume, and you were to dilute it by weight weight, the final concentration is also in micrograms per mil or weight volume. The only time you really need to use a density of the standard solution for a conversion is if you are performing a sample preparation or dilution where you're weighing out an aliquot and bringing it up to a volume, and you need to perform a conversion at that point. But I would say that for this particular question, if you are doing all of your preparations by weight, say 1 gram of standard diluted to 100 grams, then the concentration in that final preparation will exactly match the concentration units that you started with. I hope that fully answers the question. Another question would be, until the new standards are available, would you suggest combining several mixed standards together to achieve analyses of all 24 elements, or would you suggest separate sequences. The new standard should be available at the very beginning of January. But if you are measuring at concentrations that are below approximately one part per million, you can mix everything together in a dilute nitric acid HCl matrix, and you'll probably have very good results with the exception of gold and mercury. As stated on the one of the last slides, the gold and mercury are primarily going to be a problem at low concentrations if the matrix is predominantly nitric acid. We have a couple of articles on our website that discuss this in greater detail, but I would suggest that if you want to simplify your life, mix everything together in a 5 to 10% HCl solution at concentrations ranging from ppb to low ppm, and you should not have any problems whatsoever. If your process or procedure or method dictates that you have to use a nitric acid matrix, you should be fine with the exception of the stability and volatility of osmium, but at nitric acid concentrations below about 5%. We have not observed problems if the analyses are conducted quickly. Just be safe. The mercury and gold are going to be your primary concerns. So the next question, currently we use gold as a stabilizer for mercury analyses. Are there any other mercury stabilizers? That's an excellent question, and it touches upon probably one of the more concerning issues about the element list, which is PPB analyses of both mercury and gold. I am personally not aware of any good stabilizer for mercury other than gold at low concentrations, but bear in mind that the only times you really need to use gold as a stabilizer for mercury is if your preparations are predominantly in nitric acid and if your solutions are in contact with plastic labware. If you were to prepare your mercury solutions or gold-containing solutions in nitric acid and the only labware that the solutions touch are glass, you probably will not have any problems, but that's difficult to avoid with a modern ICP sample introduction system because of the transfer tubing, pump tubing, etc. This is a very good question, though, and what we'll do is we will look at trying to find another mercury stabilizer, another stabilizer for mercury other than gold. The concerns would just be that it might introduce more problems than it solves. But if you were to do all of your preparations in 5 to 10% HCl, then you can measure both mercury and gold in plastic solution containers at PPB levels, and you should have no problems whatsoever. In many, many ways, if your process allows you to use HCl as the primary matrix component, life gets much, much easier for the 24 elements that are listed in the methods. Do we have standards at part per billion levels for arsenic speciation analyses? Not as stock products, but we can certainly prepare arsenic speciation standards at concentrations that are below our normal stock product levels. And this would be for the arsenic plus 3 and the arsenic plus 5. I think that the concerns would just be if you are wanting to mix these arsenic speciation standards as part of a greater analysis. But what we would ask is that if you could provide more information regarding the exact analytical details, we could make specific recommendations. But just to prepare arsenic 3 and arsenic 5 speciation standards at PPB levels, that's not a concern. haven't seen any other questions for a couple of minutes. This would be a good opportunity to mention that also on our website we have a technical questions answered part, or a link in our technical center. It currently has about 450 questions, very similar to what people have been asking during this presentation. We have very detailed answers. They cover everything from measurement issues, sample preparation, chemical compatibility and stability, and it has a very nice search function where you can search on a term, things of that nature. And so we would recommend that people who are seeking particular details visit that technical forum. Just do a quick search, and you're probably going to find some neat information there. Great. Thank you, everybody, for participating and attending today. We certainly appreciate it. I haven't seen any questions for a few minutes, and I think it's probably appropriate this time to conclude the presentation. As stated on the last slide, technical support is available to everyone. It's something that we specialize in. We'll be happy to answer any specific questions regarding the topic discussed today or any other general technical questions you might have regarding sample preparation, analyses, things of that nature. Thank you for your time.